Macmillan Australia Audio presents Girlhood, written and read by Maggie Dent. I was born and raised on the lands of the Noongar peoples of Western Australia, and I wish to acknowledge and pay my respects to elders past, present and emerging. I thank you for being the custodians of my homeland, the country of my childhood, which I carry within my heart every day of my life. I wrote and recorded this audiobook on the lands of the Darawal peoples of the south coast of New South Wales. I also acknowledge and pay my respects to elders, past, present and emerging. The ancient knowledge and wisdom that our First Nations people, who are the longest surviving culture in the world, have known and shared for thousands of years, still has value for our modern world. May we all find ways to walk gently and compassionately on these ancient lands and come to a place where every child ever born is respected, valued, and has a strong sense of belonging. I dedicate this book to my precious granddaughters, Elia, Mila, Esme, and Mabel. You bring so much sunshine and light into my world, and I'm the luckiest and proudest grandmother ever. I look forward to many fun adventures together and many hours of sharing stories, crazy dancing, singing badly, and laughing loudly. We will walk together, garden together, swim together, and cook together. I promise to always see you, hear you, and hold you unconditionally in my heart. These are the greatest gifts I can give to you. All my love, always, Nanny. The foreword to Girlhood is by Tracey Spicer, AM, and was written in April 2022. Maggie Dent is a national treasure. For as long as I can remember, Maggie has been advocating for raising well-rounded children by building strong foundations. As the mother of two teenagers, 16-year-old Grace and 17-year-old Taj, I found her books, speeches and interviews full of priceless advice, particularly around resilience and self-esteem. Maggie uses a compelling blend of research, common sense and humour to explain complex concepts in an easy-to-understand language. Girlhood, raising our little girls to be healthy, happy and heard, is a masterclass in nurturing 0 to 8s during those formative years. Within these pages, you'll find plenty of practical tools to teach girls to harness their imaginations, use nature play as a way of healing, and find the stillness within, whether they're a dandelion or an orchid. You'll learn about the hyper-aroused state triggered by overuse of small screens and why banning technology isn't necessarily the answer. Bravely, Maggie tackles some contentious areas, like the nature-nurture debate with her trademark combination of academic and personal insights. She acknowledges that the word girl can be quite limiting, digging deep into gender identity, which is being influenced from the moment we are born. One example is the subtle conditioning around the notion that girls need to be less physically active and spend more time playing passively than boys. My husband and I have always found our girl to be far more physically active than her brother, which is something we encourage from a very young age. As a society, we don't often discuss girls who are neurodivergent. By way of example, for too long the focus was predominantly on boys with autism spectrum disorders. Maggie suggests that parents of daughters with ADHD reframe their way of thinking because it can be a pathway to a superpower or a significant gift. A lifelong feminist, she celebrates the expanding role of fathers in children's lives, the importance of the sisterhood, and the thorny topic of mean girls. The latter concept has always fluxed me. To be honest, I've found it hard to discuss this with our feminist daughter when she asks for guidance. Maggie provides a real-world framework for contextualizing these interactions, giving girls a gift for life in building supportive female friendships. Much of this book focuses on tips for managing anxiety in young girls. Maggie writes magnificently about meditation, mindfulness, and gratitude, detailing how to create a regular practice. She urges us to nurture our girls' sacred spirit. Now, you might be thinking, I'm a busy parent. How will I ever find time to read this book? Well, I have good news for you. Maggie chunks pertinent information into clearly labelled boxes so that you can snack in and out depending on the challenges you are currently facing. Perhaps my favourite parts of the book are Maggie's hard-won wisdoms from a life well lived. She doesn't shy away from difficult experiences or sugarcoat the truth. Her upbringing made her who she is today, forged by fire. You will love this book. Please share it with family and friends. Let's work with Maggie to create a robust platform for girls to be happy, healthily, and crucially heard. Tracey's accolades include New South Wales Premier of the Year, Agenda Setter of the Year 2018, Women's Agenda Recipient, Sydney Peace Prize for the Me Too Movement, winner of Social Enterprise category, 100 Women of Influence. Introduction. I have been called an undisputed boy champion, largely because I am a mum of only boys, four in total, and have advocated for a better understanding of our boys in order to reverse some pretty shoddy statistics. So, it might be asked, what is a boy champion doing writing a book about little girls? Well, to begin with, of the eight major books I have written, only two have been exclusively about boys. The rest of my work has been about all children. My initial motivation for writing this book is simple. I have four precious granddaughters. Research clearly reveals that our girls are swimming in opportunity, yet floundering in unprecedented levels of confusion, self-doubt, self-harm, anxiety, and stress. My most unsettling sense about tween and teen girls living in our consumer-driven, digital world is that the sacredness of femininity has been lost or significantly diminished. The overt pressure to be perfect, to never fail, and to be in constant competition with other girls and women is contributing to the increasing unwellness of our girls, especially in the tween and teen years. Some argue that our girls' confidence drops by 30% between the ages of 8 and 14. That is enormous and extremely concerning. We must discover how we can nurture our girls before they turn 8 so that they're able to step onto the pathway to womanhood with the mindset, life skills, resilience, courage, and necessary human connectedness and relational safety they need to grow into happy, healthy women who feel accepted, valued, respected, and heard. There are many books written by passionate, wise champions for our girls from 10 years old upwards. However, there is very little written about the years from pre-birth to age 8. The first stage of childhood is incredibly vital, so my focus is on that window. A whole body of research shows us that the first 6 years of an individual's life is when a sense of self or identity is shaped, the creation of the human mind occurs, self-regulating systems are formed, belief systems and mindsets are created. Social norms are conditioned and embedded in the mind. 90% of the brain is shaped and formed. Physical strengths and coordination can develop. Emotional and social competence can develop. The senses of feeling safe and loved are formed. and childlike spirituality is shaped. I wanted to explore what can be done in the early years of our young girls' lives to build the strong connectedness that every child needs. Healthy mindset, vital protective factors and inspiration, and hope for everyone raising daughters today. If you're a parent of a little girl and you want her to avoid struggling with poor confidence, low self-esteem, crippling anxiety, self-loathing, and a lack of courage, especially in her adolescent years, then this audiobook is exactly what you need. I have again turned to parents and educators via an online survey to see what would be most valuable to explore in a book about young girls. I also sought to capture the voices of little girls through anecdotes and by getting their parents and early educators to ask them some simple questions, such as, when are you happiest? It was by far my biggest survey with almost 5,000 responses, and the results helped me enormously to shape my research and writing. Thank you, if you're a concerned grown up who responded. The voices of little girls are all through the book. I had to make sure their voices were heard in a book about them. Even though I have raised 4 sons, I have plenty of experience with girls. I was a girl myself. Not only that, I have 2 sisters, and I'm a very proud auntie to many beautiful nieces. I am also a non-biological auntie to many more young women, and I have seen them grow from girls to women. In my teaching career, I have always taught in co-ed schools. In my counselling years, I would have seen 75% more girls than boys. While I was living in Western Australia, I ran retreats for women for over 15 years, and I saw that it is so often the experiences of the early years that become stories we tell ourselves, stories that come back to haunt us in womanhood. This is why my focus is on how we can positively shape the early years of our girls' lives rather than try and fix problems later in life. Prevention is always much better than cure. Background. As a mum of all boys, I often got the message that people thought girls were much more easy to raise than boys, and that one day you would have someone to take care of you when you became elderly. This implied that boys were harder work to raise and incapable of being caring or sensitive, especially towards their mothers. Both of these are only part truths based on social constructs. Girls think they are cleverer, more successful, and more hardworking than boys from as young as 4, according to a recent study. In Australia, statistics that come from the Australian Early Development Census and the longitudinal study of Australian children show that a statistically significant number of our young boys struggle with transition to big school. Experienced early years educators have been telling me for years that there is a noticeable difference between young boys and girls, regardless of the reasons why. Neil Farmer, an experienced early years educator and author in the UK, suggests that this appears to be the result of inappropriate learning and teaching strategies allied to lower expectations, which result in a self-fulfilling prophecy. The messages in this book are also important for extended family, educators, community members, and coaches and coordinators of extracurricular activities. In the survey of almost 5,000 parents that I conducted for this book, it was clear what worries parents. In response to what societal pressures worry parents the most for our girls under 8, they selected, in order of concern, 1, a focus on how they look rather than who they are. 2, pressure to be people pleasers. 3, girls being conditioned to be nice or a good girl. 4, gendered clothes, toys and expectations. 5, pressure to rely on boys and men to help with things requiring strength and bravery. Given that the top concern was about appearance, the pressure to focus on how they look rather than who they are, followed by girls being conditioned to be nice or be good, there is much to be done in shifting some of these conscious and unconscious pressures. Other key areas of concern were around her emotional world, especially meltdowns and tantrums, anxiety and irrational fears, moods and sensitivities. The survey also showed clearly the things that challenged parents of young girls up to the age of 4. 1. Meltdowns and tantrums. 2. Resistance to things. 3. Anxiety and irrational fears. 4. Her moods. 5. Sensitivities. 6. Mean behaviours. For those with older girls up to 8, the top concerns were similar. 1. Friendship dramas. 2. Anxiety and irrational fears. 3. Meltdowns and tantrums. 4. Resistance to things. 5. Her moods. There was lots of good news in the survey too, as it showed overwhelmingly the things that fascinate and amaze parents about little girls. When presented with the question, "What has amazed you about the girls in your life?" and a list of suggestions, these are the ones parents selected in order. 1. Use of imagination. 2. Verbal maturity, use of big words, etc. 3. Memory. 4. Caring capacity, in other words, for people, animals, dead bugs even. 5. Tuning into other kids' feelings. 6. Problem-solving capacity. 7. Fine motor skills. 8. Physical ability, in other words, gross motor skills. 9. Bravery. As a grandmother, I too have been absolutely fascinated with some of the deep conversations I have had with my granddaughters. I've been impressed with their memory capabilities, organisation skills, their ability to communicate, their tendency to be feisty and stubborn, full of energy, adventuresome and brave, as well as creative. And their imaginations have astounded me often. As quoted in Mary Axness's Parenting for Peace, which was published in 2012, quote, "Your child is not a blank slate or an empty vessel who needs to be filled up with copious amounts of excellent information. Your child comes to you with a nascent intellect that is consolidating energy and waiting to unfold in good time like a flower in the bud. You would never pry open a rosebud to somehow optimize or improve upon it. Instead, you would make sure it has the best soil and nourishing fertilizer to support its optimal unfolding." This audiobook is for anyone who is on the journey of raising girls to be happy, healthy, and heard. This book is for everyone who lives with or works with little girls. However, it is especially for parents, grandparents, and key caregivers. In the formative years, this circle of influence molds a girl's mind, body, and heart more than anything else in the world. And those formative years shape everything in our little ones' lives. We all want the best for our girls, especially given the extra pressures and challenges presented by living in a digital age. We want our girls to grow up to accept and embrace themselves and to create their own place in the world where they can find genuine meaning and purpose. We want them to find their strengths and passions and to connect deeply with their heart and their spirit. Every single child is born with a unique blend of ancestral influences, biological drivers, and a mix of masculine and feminine in a body that has never been on earth before, which means that discovering who your daughter is begins at the moment of birth. A major part of this book is designed to help you discover your daughter's unique strengths, attributes and the possible challenges that will shape who she can become and will become. Hopefully, you'll find some of the missing clues that will help you to better understand your daughter and to help you as a parent to make choices that will allow her to shine in her own unique way. You may also help your daughter come to understand herself better so that she can genuinely accept, embrace, and love herself as authentically and as honestly as she can. Let's give our girls the best possible start in life by surrounding them with environments full of caring humans in supportive communities who value an unrushed childhood. Please let our girls be little girls for as long as possible. Let's focus on strengthening our little girls' minds, bodies, hearts, and spirits by creating a strong, fertile soil for them to grow in while protecting them from unhelpful cultural messaging. Collectively, we can help not only our daughters, granddaughters, and nieces, we can help all little girls in our neighbourhoods and communities to have a happier, healthier life. Before we continue, I need to give a disclaimer, which is one that I offer with all my work. Gender is more fluid than fixed, and while respecting biological, neurological, and hormonal differences, there is not an all-boys or all-girls reality. On top of that, there is the social conditioning that is deeply embedded in culture and ancestry. So, when I use the term girls, I will be referring to a statistically significant number of girls. However, much of what we will be sharing may also be relevant to boys and people of other gender identities. I encourage you to take from this what feels right for you. All genders need to be seen as equally fabulous, especially our gender-fluid children. Every child ever born is a unique miracle with their own individuality. Chapter 1. Mothering Your Daughter. I secretly wished to be only the mother of boys. The main reason I didn't want to have a daughter was because of the struggles I had had as a little girl and as a teenager. I had always found boys much less complicated, not only as siblings, but also as friends. In a way, I may have created a belief that the scars from my childhood would mean I would struggle to mother a daughter. Writing this book took me down the rabbit hole of exploring my own childhood and life. So there are many parts in this book where I mention mothering daughters rather than fathering daughters. I did some research with the mothers of daughters, particularly ones who have only just stepped into the tween years, to see what are their main concerns, worries, and joys about mothering a daughter today. The mother-daughter relationship that each mother experiences as a child was very much in the back of their minds as they began their journey with their daughter. Some had really loving, wonderful mothers and hoped to repeat the same patterns and behaviours. Others had had mothers who were harsher, more distant, and definitely less communicative and wanted to be a very different mother to their own daughters. Mothering a daughter can be triggering or healing to your own experience as a daughter. In fact, it can be either or both of these things. It certainly was for me when thinking about the girls in my life and being reminded of my own girlhood. Some mums have shared with me that they really wanted their daughters to end up better than them. For some, this meant completing their education because they had not, or excelling at something that they perceived they had failed at. For others, it was that they yearned to have a close, loving relationship with their daughter for their whole life, different from what they had had with their own mothers. If any of these apply to you, consider that this wish is actually an unfair burden to place on your little girl. She's come onto this earth to be her own unique self, not to fulfill any of your unfinished dreams or life plans. Given that most mothers today have experienced the conditioning of the patriarchal system, many were very clear that they wanted their daughters to realize that they can be both brave and gentle, courageous and tender, and they deserve to be loved and respected exactly as they are. Many of these mothers had been conditioned to be nice, to be quiet, and to put others before themselves. They also acknowledged how difficult it can be to parent your daughter with these shifting social norms and that they don't always get it right. A response in the Parents and Educators survey said, "My daughter is a real character. She's energetic, funny, and sensitive to others. She loves being silly with me, and we often sing together, make funny songs and characters and voices. She is a joy to have around. She forever repeats my parenting remarks to my son, like she knows what to do better than him, and is 7 years younger than him. She's 8. One of the most important things I learned in personal growth work was that there is only one person who sees the world as you see it, and that is you. There is only one person who has created stories from their childhood, which influence them consciously and unconsciously, and many of those stories may not be true. I have worked with a lot of mothers who have had an unhealthy attitude to tidiness that often bordered on obsession. They shared how they would be triggered to become the shouting, angry mother by a toddler's messy toys, an unmade bed, or a dishwasher that was not packed according to her standards. A psychologist once shared with me that this pattern of behaviour can be a way of having control in the outer world because there is little order in the inner or emotional world. He also suggested that for many girls, their worth and value was determined through external efforts like tidiness, dressing neatly, having their hair done well, and speaking quietly. This is not saying that having a tidy home is a bad thing. It is suggesting that if you feel anxious and stressed when your house is not perfect, then you may be unconsciously telling yourself a story that is not true and could be healed. Rachel Macy Stafford, a best-selling American author, discovered that her expectations for her daughters and her husband were not only unrealistic, they were creating misery for everyone. Rather than nurturing her family, she was controlling and managing them according to her unhealthy reality. She identified that she was a control freak and began a journey of self-healing. She was quoted on the website positiveparentingsolutions.com saying, "I spoke words of love. When I reacted to small everyday inconveniences as if they were a major catastrophe, when normal human habits and quirks raise my blood pressure to dangerous levels. The mental fatigue and overwhelm of many mothers may be a sign that expectations may be out of step with reality. Having babies, toddlers, and young children is exhausting without working full-time and maintaining a schedule of household chores, regular exercise, self-care, personal appearances, and personal relationships. Juggling a career and motherhood can be done. However, some things may need to be more relaxed. For example, I created a lucky dip bed where I put all the clean washing because I was not prepared to spend an hour a day folding clothes and putting them in the boys' bedrooms. I did not have that spare time. And I noticed it made me really frustrated and resentful when I tried to do it." One thing that came up often in counselling, in retreats, and in conversations I have had with mums is just how hard mothers are on themselves. Women tend to constantly compare themselves to others or beat themselves up unnecessarily by reviewing their day and looking at ways they could do it better. One of the toughest things to learn when you have a new baby, then a free-spirited toddler, is that you can't control them or their lives, and it's not your job to try. Your job is to work out how to meet their unique needs as best you can. Judging ourselves harshly is something we learn in the early years of our lives. This is why one of my key mantras around parenting is that there is no perfect, that good enough parents who succeed often and fail sometimes, can still raise healthy, happy children. So please, put down the stick that you are beating yourself with and give yourself some kindness and compassion. Practicing genuine self-care is another challenge for many of today's mothers. It can easily trigger guilt because they have been conditioned to care for everyone else ahead of themselves. This took me quite some time to tame, and I burned out twice, and my body became so exhausted and depleted, I suffered two life-threatening illnesses. It was these illnesses that were the wake-up call that I needed and deserved, telling me to take the time to look after myself and do things that restored me and gave me joy. Many of the mothers expressed that they had learned that the things that triggered them most about their daughters were more about them than their daughters. This is one of the things you learn quite early in therapy, that an experience that challenges you, that your daughter may unintentionally trigger, is not about her, but about you. It is the mirror effect. It can be really hard to accept that your unconscious mind is working hard to shine a light on the unhealed parts of you, but it is important to do so, so that you can become a better human being. Most of our emotional scars are fairly insignificant. However, some can impact us later in life in so many ways. I was the fifth of six children, and my mother was not an emotionally warm parent. I created a story that she didn't love me, which also created another story that I was unlovable. These stories created beliefs that in turn influenced the choices I made not only as a child, but also as a teenage girl and a young mum. And I spent a number of years working in therapy and doing personal growth workshops to be able to make peace with my inner child, learning to accept and love myself exactly as I am. There are many family therapists and life coaches who can help you change the stories of your childhood if they are negatively impacting how you are raising your daughter. Imagine that you have a small child within yourself, the same age as the daughter who is triggering you. This can help to navigate where the truth really lies. And if your pain is really about your daughter or yourself. Dr. Vanessa LaPointe, in Parenting Right from the Start, published in 2019, has said, "Nothing about natural, normal, healthy child development is triggering or upsetting. Bear that in mind if you're feeling fired up by what you observe in your child. This is a call for you to explore why you are reacting the way you are." There were many times when I was working with a rebellious teenage girl who was escaping out the bedroom window, drinking and smoking and not going to school, that I found that this had been the mother's experience as well. Unhealed patterns can be unconsciously passed on to our children, no matter how hard we try to prevent it. The only way to ensure a trauma does not resurface in your daughter's life is to shine a light onto your own experience. A response in the Parents and Educators survey said, "When she was 4.5 asking me, 'Mum, do you like being a mum?' I responded with the cliche, 'Of course, I love you and being your mum is wonderful, etc.' And she responds with, 'Yes, but do you like it?' Such awareness blows my mind." Much has changed in the last 20 to 30 years in the research around what matters most in the healthy raising of children. Behaviorism was the flavor of the last century, where parents were told that children's behavior was something they chose, and that using rewards when children behaved how we wanted them to, and punishment when they behaved in ways we didn't want them to, was the best way to raise good children. The pressure was to control children, often with fear. And sadly, this often came at the cost of emotional connection and relational safety. Not only are we influenced by the way we were parented, we can also be influenced by our family's history. There is significant research that shows we are likely to replicate the programs of our parents, even if we consciously have chosen not to. Early childhood is unpredictable, messy, often noisy, and most parents will struggle with sleep deprivation and confusion about how they can be the parent they really want to be. And this is completely normal. There is no way that parents can be perfect and meet every need of their precious little ones. It is impossible. We all carry scars of disappointment from our childhood, and it is the big scars that really shape the programming and the patterns that we unconsciously follow when become parents. Trauma of any kind increases our chances of struggling with mental health, addictions, and deep and profound self-loathing that tends to surface in the adolescent years. Adverse childhood experiences, ACEs, can occur around experiences of significant accidents or illnesses, death and loss, natural disasters, family violence, abandonment, deprivation, or abuse. Our bodies and our unconscious minds remember these experiences and often bury emotional pain deep, especially when we have experienced shame. We all have secrets from our childhood that we consciously or unconsciously keep buried. Our amazing minds and bodies do anything they can so that they can survive, because survival is the number one biological drive of every human. But this survival comes at a cost. One therapist suggested that we have a life force that pulses through us, and when we have buried a painful secret or wound, it takes much of that life force to keep it hidden. When it is exposed to the light and is no longer a secret, we have a stronger life force to keep us healthier and happier. A response in the Parents and Educators survey said, "I worry about meltdowns and tantrums. I would call these big feelings. And while we actually didn't struggle much with these because of wonderful, respectful parenting books, the most challenging moments and times when I had to take a long, hard look at myself and my approach were all around big feelings or resistance to sleep." As the stigma around mental health is gradually being challenged and hopefully dissolved, more and more people are seeking help to understand themselves and to heal unhealthy beliefs and patterns of behaviour. I began my self-healing journey when I was around 30 and already the mother of three little boys. Every time I peeled away another layer of my wounded inner child, my life improved, especially my capacity to be the loving mother I wanted to be. It helped me to deconstruct the stories I had created from my childhood that were simply not true. Most importantly, it allowed me to come to a place of unconditional acceptance and love of myself, warts and all. If you have never done any work on your inner child, a good place to begin is the work of Brené Brown. The mothers I spoke to all agreed that when they began to work on themselves, their relationships improved not only with their daughters, but with their life partners as well. Therapy comes in all shapes and sizes, from programs that last a year to weekly ones, weekend ones, online ones, and one-on-one therapy. It's important to find out what works for you. The retreats for women that I run were often attended by women who had no concept of how the wounded child within them influences who they are today. Indeed, one retreat happened over a Mother's Day weekend, and it was interesting to note that every woman there had had a difficult or toxic relationship with their mother. A response in the Parents and Educators survey said, 6 years old. She has a 12-year-old brother and loves to tell him off. We have to remind her that we have the parenting covered. Mothering daughters can definitely be really tricky, and yet it can be the most amazing journey you may ever experience. Your daughter has come to be a mirror for you, to allow you to grow and to transform into the higher expression of yourself. There will be times that you will struggle with overprotecting her instead of letting her stretch and grow in her own courage. There will be times she will share her tender secrets that will make your heart melt. There will be times that she will stand with her hands on her hips and confront you to face your own truth like no other person could. Embrace it all, Mummy, with curiosity, compassion, and as much patience as you can. It will be worth it. Chapter 2, First 1,000 Days. Technically, the first 1,000 days of a child's life are from the moment of conception until their second birthday. Research over the past 20 years has shown that by focusing on this window, especially by meeting the unique needs of pregnant women, babies, and toddlers, we can significantly improve the trajectory of a child's life. A strong, healthy start is not just about safety, good nutrition, and receiving support. While all of this is incredibly important, creating a robust and secure start in life goes even deeper. Humans are a social species, which means we're meant to live in relationships, in systems, such as families and communities. This sense of belonging and safety can impact babies even before birth. The research is quite strong that intergenerational trauma or trauma experienced during pregnancy can significantly impact the developing baby. At a conference I attended in Vancouver in Canada in 2012, American pediatrician Professor W. Thomas Boyce gave a lecture titled "What the Genes Remember: The New Epigenetics of the Early Years." In groundbreaking longitudinal research, it was shown that childhood adversity, particularly poor attachment, by age 3.5, can change the genes, especially their serotonin transporter gene. This in turn will increase the chances of school failure, chronic illness such as diabetes and cancer, heart disease, and cardiac death. I have to be honest, I was pretty stunned at that moment. To think that the genomes in our DNA can change after birth due to environmental influences challenged everything about the nurture versus nature debate. Essentially, this means that no matter what DNA a child is born with, the influences of nurture, that is, the environment they are in, can change that coding. And it works both ways. Safe, loving environments can change the DNA positively, while environments where babies and toddlers feel threatened or unsafe can set them on a trajectory towards ill health. As girls often have better memories and can be more emotionally responsive, their environment is a particularly important influence. A response in the Parents and Educators survey said, "When our daughter Greta was 18 months old, we used to hold the four corners of a sheet with our best friends and gently swing her in it. Her laugh and absolute joy at both the movement and the four loving faces smiling down at her is one of my best memories of her early years." The first fundamental need for all babies is to have strong, safe, and warm connectedness with their key caregivers, hopefully their biological parents, or with other adults who are present significantly in their lives. This is called attachment, and it is the superglue that holds a child in close proximity to a parent or caregiver. A child is meant to seek or pursue proximity, which means being close to their big person, so they feel safe and so they are safe. Attachment is as important to healthy child development as eating or sleeping. Much of the research indicates that strong attachment and bondedness can be among the most significant influences on emotional well-being, mental health, and physical health for life. The research that our little ones need to be completely dependent on us in order to grow into their own independence in the future is also quite compelling. One of the key features of healthy attachment is that the grown-ups caring for a baby are sensitive to and respond to the infant's unique cues and needs with warmth and tenderness. Ensure your little girl knows you will always be her safe base. If your daughter needs to find her way into your bed, sometimes for a night or two, or sometimes for a few weeks or longer, it can be a sign that the outside world has become a little more uncertain for her. Every new experience, like starting to eat solids, too much sensory stimulation, changes in key caregivers, or change of bed, is a potential stress trigger that can overwhelm the nervous system. Given that poor sleep impacts every level of a child's life, please prioritise getting good sleep. Meet her fears and anxiety with comfort and soothing. As she gets older, she will be able to better manage her nervous system, and one day you will miss the fact that she no longer wants to curl beside you at night. In my book, 9 Things, A Back to Basics Guide to Calm, Common Sense, Connected Parenting, Birth to 8, the first of the 9 things is called connected mothering. What really matters is that our little ones are mothered well, which means they come to experience a strong sense of healthy connectedness and attachment. Fathers can mother, grandparents can mother, foster parents can mother, step-parents can mother. Connected mothering takes enormous amounts of time and energy in the first 1,000 days of life, but it needs to be a priority for anyone who becomes a parent. In traditional cultures, women were surrounded by many other women having babies and raising little ones. There was always a warm lap and a tender heart close by, and all children were seen as the responsibility of everyone in the kinship village. As civilization has progressed, the reality of having a supportive and caring village around a new parent has become more difficult to achieve. However, living through a global pandemic has emphasized to us how incredibly important our long-distance village still remains for our emotional and mental well-being, especially in the absence of face-to-face communication and safe, intimate touch. When your firstborn is born, so too are you born as a parent. Biological parents can experience a significant identity shift in the first 1,000 days of their newborn's life, and it can be a confusing time, no matter how much you love your new baby. Dr. Vanessa LaPointe conveys it in her parenting right from the start. Then your child arrives. You feel the earth move beneath you. Your axis tilts. You're in the midst of one of the most incredible psychological and emotional shifts a human being can experience. You are now a parent responsible for another life in this world. It is important to remember that parenting is one of the hardest things you will ever do, and ensuring you have access to support, guidance, and respite really does help. All parents can benefit from the formal and informal supports of positive people who care and who they can rely on when some of those tricky, challenging experiences arrive, often unexpectedly. A response in the Parents and Educators survey said, between the age of 18 months and 3, our eldest daughter would play tea parties with us. As she didn't have any liquid to put in her cup, she would recycle water from her drink bottle and then to the cup. She would then offer it to her family and friends to drink, and she insisted very heavily on drinking it as well. We always tried to have a towel on our laps to help us. Our world of screens and technology is definitely displacing some of the wonderful, authentic, and meaningful connectedness that little ones need with safe grown-ups. Nothing works better than humans interacting with humans in the same room. Here's a Maggie main idea. Our little ones are biologically wired to learn how to be human and communicate as humans, but this will only happen around other humans. John Medina, in his book Brain Rules for Baby, wrote about research that showed that babies and toddlers under 3 years of age do not tend to take in sound from external sources like TVs and iPads. They are biologically wired to process sounds from humans because they are learning how communication, including non-verbal communication, takes place. Facial expressions are being wired into your little ones at the same time. The first 1,000 days is a fantastic window within which to marinate little girls in as much human sound as possible, preferably out of the mouths of humans. Reading to them, singing to them, and talking to them not only helps to build that relationship, it is forming the foundations in their brain so they can understand fundamental sounds that will help them communicate and learn how to read in the future. A study by Hart and Risley, 1995, shows that the greater the amount of language a child hears in the early years, the better they will be able to read. The study found that families in high socioeconomic situations tend to speak more to their children, and the difference was estimated to be 30 million words over the first 5 years of life. Children from a higher income family were exposed to nearly twice as many words as working class children, and close to four times as many words as children from families on welfare. There is no question that smartphones are stealing precious moments of communication between little ones and their key grown-ups, and this can lead to a form of digital abandonment. If you have forgotten the words to nursery rhymes or songs that children like, by all means use your technology to find the words, but the secret is to sing along with the child, not just allow the remote sound to take place. As a grandparent, I've been quite annoying for my sons and daughter-in-laws with my endless singing of the wheels on the bus, this old man, five little ducks, and twinkle, twinkle, little star. Thankfully, my grandchildren do not care that I really can't sing in tune. My favourite site for wonderful audio resources in Australia is the ABC Kids Listen app. A response in the Parents and Educators survey said, when she was about 16 to 18 months, old, she was obsessed with In the Night Garden show. She got a washing basket and hopped in with Iggle Piggle toy on her own, displaying her ability of recalling stories and shows. The wonderfully wise Sally Goddard Blythe, director of the Institute for Neurophysiological Psychology in the UK, has concerns about parenting today. She has observed that our modern world is making it more difficult for babies and toddlers to spend significant time with their parents, which is where she believes the healthiest mothering can occur. On reading Goddard Blythe's book, What Babies and Children Really Need, 2008, it turns out what they really need, time, is what many 21st century parents simply cannot provide because we live in a society that does not allow for it. Many countries prioritise potential economic well-being over the real, genuine well-being of little ones. If society acknowledged and promoted the importance of the first 1,000 days to the future growth and well-being of their children, parents might be able to make different choices when navigating the journey of raising their young ones. This does not mean they're unable to work or that being a working mum is a negative thing. It simply suggests that choices around who cares for their baby would be made much more consciously. The importance of secondary attachment. Many countries in the world have recognised the importance of primary attachment, and they provide paid parental leave to either or both their parents. Secondary attachment is not only possible, it is seriously valuable. This occurs when a baby or a toddler has a sense of strong connectedness to a grown-up who is not a biological parent. This can include grandparents, nannies, or early childhood educators. A response in the Parents and Educators survey said, my dad looked after my girl before she went to daycare and school. At around 18 months old, I came home and they were both giggling like crazy. Dad was pretending to drop balls and she was in non-stop giggle mode. They were both red and breathless from laughing. Such a simple thing that brought so much joy. I once worked with an early childhood centre in Sydney and I was curious about the age of the youngest child that they'd ever cared for. The director remembered instantly a little girl who was born on the Friday and brought to them 1 week later. The girl's mother was a project manager for a large corporation and was needed back at work much earlier than she had hoped. The director explained the staff were tearful on that first day. They cried because they were being gifted such an important tiny baby to take care of, and they cried with sadness for the mother-child relationship. Two of the educators were assigned to be significant secondary attachment figures, and the little girl attended the centre until she began school. After she had begun primary school, she would often drop by on her way home from school to catch up with her special grown-ups. The director had tears in her eyes as she explained that these same two educators had been invited to her high school graduation. Such was the loving bond the girl still felt. Here's a Maggie Main idea. The research is compelling that the minimum that every child needs in their life is one strong, safe attachment figure, biological or otherwise. Any more than one is wonderful, and that is what creating a family tribe is really all about. For working parents who have significant adult carers for their sensitive children, especially working mums who may have guilt around this issue, the key advice is to 1. If possible, delay having your child cared for outside of your home, especially full-time, for as long as possible in the first 1,000 days. Number 2. Transition gradually so that your child can adapt to the change. 3. Develop a special relationship with one key early childhood educator as your child transitions into care. Build this relationship slowly and gently if possible. 4. View your early childhood educators as an extension of your family and work together to identify the unique needs of your child and create ways to respond to them that are consistent. I do have some good news about little girls. They do tend to be better at bonding to key caregivers. In one study, it was noted that if a baby girl was lifted out of her cot, she was more likely to focus on the face of the grown-up who had picked her up than a baby boy was. Given neuroscience has shown the incredible importance of mirroring due to the presence of mirror neurons, it means that baby girls can form stronger attachments earlier and more efficiently. The phenomenon of smartphones has led to a tendency for mothers to be engaged in what has been called brexting, which is either texting, scrolling, or engaging in social media when feeding babies. Given the incredible importance of face-to-face connection, this is something to be aware of. However, I do know how incredibly supportive it can be for the mothers of babies and restless toddlers to be able to connect to friends and mother allies in the wee hours of the morning, so it is not all bad. The long-term impacts of poor attachment. Much has changed in the last 20 to 30 years in the research around what matters most in the healthy raising of children. However, so much comes from the experiences that impacted us as little ones. I was once asked to work with a 13-year-old girl who was struggling with her transition into high school. She experienced incredibly strong anxiety and panic attacks, even though she had friends at the same school. When we explored where this may have been coming from, we identified that her transition into kindergarten as a 4-year-old had been traumatic. She was very sensitive, and in the first weeks of kindergarten, she had clung sobbing to her mother. Her mother stayed beside her for a few mornings to help her settle, and after a couple of weeks, the teacher said it was time to be firmer. The next day, she forcibly removed the girl from her mother and sent her mother away. The little girl was extremely distressed, and to avoid the mother from hearing her and to avoid upsetting the other children, the teacher put the girl in a storeroom and locked the door. As this girl was transitioning into high school, she was being triggered from the emotional memory of that highly distressing experience. We worked closely together with her, her family, and the school, and gradually we were able to facilitate a transition that felt safe to her. As a beautiful ending to this story, in her final year at school, this girl had the lead role in the school musical. Her performance was positively stunning, and her confidence and perseverance was inspiring. When I was counselling full-time, I was often asked to work with young girls who were struggling with emotional memories from before birth or at birth. Even before they understand language, they are growing stories or narratives in their mind. One little girl, who was almost 4, struggled with a lack of joie de vivre. She seemed to be sad a lot of the time and seldom responded with laughter or joy. even around times like birthdays and Christmas. When I was working with a mother, I asked her to tell me how her pregnancy had been with her little daughter. At first, she said her pregnancy had been healthy, and then she paused. She remembered that just after she found out she was pregnant at around 10 weeks gestation, her best girlfriend had been killed in a car accident. The sudden tragedy had impacted her deeply, and she had cried most days of her pregnancy. I suggested that maybe her daughter had picked up the sadness from before she was born and in some way was feeling responsible for her mother's sadness. Being marinated in grief while in utero seemed like the most logical explanation for her daughter's sadness. Up until around the age of 5, reality and imagination can both appear quite real for little ones, especially highly imaginative little girls. Play therapy and art therapy are definitely ways to help little ones process adverse childhood experiences and trauma. As I had done some training in these therapies, I used a version of colour therapy to help the little girl draw what her sadness felt like and where it was in her body. Then she drew a different picture of how it would feel to be happy, safe, and loved. Quite often, little girls use the colours of the rainbow, and this is what this little girl chose. After that, she began learning some simple breath work to release the colours of sadness and fill her body with the colours of the rainbow. Then, using her imagination and with her mother close by, we created an imaginary journey for her daughter. The visualization involved a simplistic version of her being born into a room full of balloons and being welcomed with enormous love and laughter from her mum and her dad. Afterwards, the little girl was noticeably much lighter. She then drew another picture and it was full of flowers, rainbows, and stars. When I caught up with this little girl a week later, the mother burst into tears of joy, saying that her daughter was like a different little girl. The sadness had gone, and she was finding it easier to laugh and be joyful. I remember clearly another little girl I worked with who was just 5 years of age. Her mum and dad asked me to work with her because there were times when she got upset, particularly with her mum, or when life was challenging, or when she had friendship issues and she said she wished she could die. Sometimes children use these words to try to express the gravity of their feelings, and they are heartbreaking words to hear from little children. I asked for some background of her pregnancy and birth because it seemed this response was coming from somewhere deeper. The mum explained that she had had a serious drug problem, and shortly after her daughter had been born, she ended up having a significantly difficult couple of years when she was using drugs and she was hopelessly addicted. Eventually, she was able to engage in rehabilitation and she has been drug-free for the previous 3 years. Given the understanding around the need for healthy attachment, we decided that the daughter may still be struggling with poor attachment with her mum despite the turnaround in her life. I used some art therapy with this little girl as well. We did a colour drawing. She released many ugly colours that represented anger, sadness, fear, feeling unloved, helpless. She then used a beautiful bright golden colour as the colour of her sense of being loved and happy. We did a similar visualisation where she was born into a wonderful loving space with a totally tender and present mum and dad, with lots of golden balloons. Her shining eyes and smiling face are still clear in my mind. As she sat up, she turned to her mum and gently wrapped her arms around her and they embraced for a number of minutes. Everyone was crying tears of joy. Weeks later, the mother contacted me to say how much happier her daughter was and that when she got upset, she no longer talked about wanting to die. Over time, emotional memories can create stories in our mind and then create beliefs such as, I'm not wanted, I'm not good enough, I am unlovable. These deep-seated beliefs can unconsciously drive behaviours and choices that we make as a child or even as an adult. However, it is when puberty happens and there is a significant growth in the limbic brain, our emotional brain, that things can become really intense. This is when that inner critic voice becomes incredibly loud and self-loathing that many girls experience can trigger anxiety, self-harm, and a deep sense of helplessness and hopelessness. Strong, loving attachment in the first 1,000 days is the best way to prevent these intense negative mindsets. Given how negative mindsets are causing so many of our tween and teen girls so much angst and worry, we really need to focus on building positive mindsets from conception, if possible. According to Robin Grill in Heart to Heart Parenting, children who are securely attached to their parents are more likely to be able to cope well with stress, have satisfying relationships, have healthy self-esteem, have good mental health, reach their full intellectual potential, have fewer behavioural problems, have fewer discipline problems, have fewer problems separating from parents when it is developmentally appropriate. Little girls are more robust than little boys. Despite the enormous influence of the shaping of gender through social constructs, research suggests that no one is completely masculine or completely feminine. Gender identity is not fixed, even though we are more soft-wired than hard-wired into our masculine and feminine traits. The relationship in the lives of our little ones can have long-lasting impacts. One of the biggest social constructs I challenged in mothering our boys was that boys are tough. Indeed, there is a fragility about our little boys that was seldom acknowledged. Statistically, boys die in utero at a higher rate than girls. They die at birth at a higher rate than girls, and they die in the first 12 months of life at a higher rate than girls. When I first read these statistics, I was surprised. How can we call little boys tough with these statistics? This is what can happen when a gender expectation or social norm can be challenged by facts, and it becomes concerning because our expectations influence our thoughts and our behaviour. There is still a strong tendency to speak more harshly to little boys than little girls, and this partly comes from the perception that they are naturally tougher. We often change the tone of our voice when we speak to girls, as though they are more likely to need our help, for example, if they fall over. Observe this in your playgrounds, early childhood settings, and schools. If grown-ups speak differently to little boys and little girls, it needs to be challenged and hopefully stopped. If we speak more harshly to boys, it tells them that they need to be tougher and ignore their vulnerability. If we speak in sweet ways with girls, we imply they are weak or more helpless, which denies their ability to be strong and brave. If a small child, regardless of gender, falls over or hurts himself, we need to ask in a warm, concerned tone, "Are you okay? Do you need a grown-up's help?" We all come from the same genetic blueprint, but a combination of factors, including a key protein, play a part in determining whether embryos become female, male, or in rare cases, intersex. Hormones are a part of the story, and for males, testosterone is the key. Well-respected neuropsychologist Dr. Alan Shaw's research demonstrates that the marinade of testosterone in utero seems to slow down the growth and development of the male baby's brain. This delay can make boys more vulnerable to social stress, also known as attachment trauma, and physical stress. Seen from another angle, little girls are born a little more advanced and better biologically wired to form healthy attachments to key caregivers from birth, which means the first 1,000 days are an important opportunity to form those attachments. Steve Bidoff writes in Raising Boys, "The testosterone effect in the womb in the first year of life slows boys' brain development, especially in the right hemisphere, so much that they are far more vulnerable than girls to anything that goes wrong." After birth, there can also be some gender differences in the way neurotransmitters interact, with boys tending to produce naturally less serotonin and less oxytocin, which have been linked by some researchers to feelings of well-being. Maybe this is why girls use communication to ensure connection, empathy, and social cohesion more often than little boys, and this could also potentially explain their tendency for greater emotional stability and regulation. Gisela Proschaff said in Raising Girls that a girl's parents are lucky. Female babies are tougher and more robust than boys. We can only speculate about all the factors that contribute to this imbalance, but we can say that cortisol, the stress hormone, and testosterone, which boys build up, heighten the vulnerability of the immune system in male infants. As previously stated, the influences of nurture can significantly impact these tendencies because nothing is fixed. Sadly, this is not always a positive thing. The good news is that at any time we can improve the influence of nurture, especially around attachment. In some studies, it has also been noted that parents are more gentle and tender in the care of their baby girls than their baby boys. In one study, grown-ups were placed with a group of infants all dressed in the same yellow jumpsuits, and they could not tell which were girls and which were boys. However, as soon as they learned what gender a child was, they reacted differently to the girls and boys and labelled the children's emotions differently. For example, seeing anger in an expression when they think the baby is a boy, but recognising fear in a girl. Yikes! This is just a small example of how gender and social conditioning of adults can influence our interactions with our little ones in the first 1,000 days. In my book, Mothering Our Boys, I say, maybe this is an unintentional influence of the widespread misapprehension that men need to be toughened up, or that maybe boys are not even sensitive in the first place. This is so wrong. Girls are shaped by the interactions of those around them, and this is why we need to be mindful of our expectations and social conditionings, even in the earliest stages of life. One area around emotional awareness that needs to change is around anger for girls. It needs to be just as acceptable for little girls to express anger as little boys. In February 2022, former Australian of the Year Grace Tame met with criticism for showing her anger via her stony facial expression in the public domain. She was quite justifiably angry about how politicians and the media had portrayed her as she fought hard to prevent the sexual abuse of children and to change the culture around silencing victims. Author and ABC broadcaster Virginia Trioli noticed that Ms. Tame's anger made many women feel uncomfortable as it went against their social conditioning to be polite and nice. Anger can be expressed without relational aggression, without name-calling, put-downs or exclusions. It surely is time for change. In February 2022, Virginia Trioli wrote a piece for the ABC in which she said, after hundreds of years of being raised in the arts of making nice, for safety, for self-preservation, for comfort and for the comfort of others, a new generation of women is stepping into their power, fueled by the unasked-for anger that is the byproduct of their trauma. And they want you to see it on their face. And they don't care if it makes you or me squirm. We are going to have to get comfortable with seeing a woman's rage. And if this generation is offering to teach us all the dark arts of refusing to make nice, I want to join their coven. Parental stress. There is no question that for the majority of parents today, parental stress is much higher than it was 30 years ago. The digital world has given access to an enormous amount of information that can be helpful for parents. However, it can also add to the confusion. Social media has had positive effects as well as some negatives. Many parents, mums especially, feel social media can provide a platform for parental competition and judgment from others. A response in the Parents and Educators survey said, at the time, my daughter was 18 months old, and of course, like any mother, I was constantly following her with my phone to film her. She was watering the garden with my dad and discovering the process about flowers and watering them. She stopped her conversation with my dad and said, "Stop taking the picture, Mama." A gentle reminder to be in and enjoy the moment. Many mums of young babies and toddlers tell me they are drowning in exhaustion and stress. The lack of a village with supportive women is costing mums of little ones in terms of their emotional and mental well-being. Being part of a group on WhatsApp or Facebook that is supportive and protective of members can be a lifesaver for many mothers who are parenting in isolation. But the opposite is also true when an exhausted mother doom scrolls or looks for connection and positivity and instead finds herself negatively impacted by disrespectful online participants. The first 1,000 days can definitely be the trickiest as a new parent. The first 12 months of a baby's life is when parents have the most disturbed sleep, and sleep deprivation is one of the biggest stressors of being a parent. Tired and exhausted mums and dads are often unable to meet the needs of their babies and toddlers with calmness and unconditional love. It is very difficult to be joyful and patient when you are exhausted. Fostering strong, healthy attachment means a child will grow up to feel loved and secure in themselves. Unconditional love is not imagining that you can have your child grow up in a field of daisies with no prickles. On some days, providing unconditional love means you'll need to dig deep inside yourself to find the strength you didn't know you had. It will mean on that day that your toddler daughter smears your most expensive face cream all over the carpet, the dog, the wardrobe and themselves, you'll be able to take a deep breath and realise that she is just a curious toddler doing exactly what she's supposed to be doing, exploring the world around her using all of her senses. Healthy attachment requires plenty of human connectedness often, but not every minute of every day. I believe that finding moments to saturate your little girl with loving interaction and respectful child-centered care in an unhurried, calm environment as much as possible is the key to achieving healthy attachment. This is impossible 100% of the time, and parents, particularly mothers, need to stop feeling anguished if they have days when things don't work out as they wished. Try to avoid self-criticism or revisiting every decision you make, especially when you're trying to fall asleep. Good enough is good enough. Everyone will have days when they will struggle. I can remember hiding in the toilet at times, wondering why I decided to have children. Strong, healthy attachment can be formed with imperfect parents who are good enough most of the time. Focus on the good moments. Be gentle with yourself. Nurture your sense of humour and surround yourself with authentic humans who genuinely care about you. Before you know it, the first 1,000 days will be done and dusted. A response in the Parents and Educators survey said, when she was 18 months old and staying with me while her parents were on holidays overseas, she wrote on the kitchen wall with crayons. Her grandpop reacted angrily. I and her grandmother smiled as I had allowed her to draw on the sides of the bathtub with water crayons a number of times. We often laugh about that day. I will leave the final words of this chapter to the wise and wonderful Dr. Vanessa LaPointe. When the dance of trust and reciprocity between parent and child is consistent, the child develops the belief that they are worthy of love and that they can simply lean into a parent's enduring embrace, physically and emotionally, to receive that love. Over the years, this consistent provision of love from the parent morphs into a consistent provision of self-love from within the child. The greatest gift a parent can give a child is to help them grow into an adult full of self-love. Key points from this chapter include: strong, healthy attachment is as important to healthy childhood development as eating or sleeping. Secondary attachment with safe grown-ups who are not parents or key caregivers can have a huge positive influence in children's lives. The more words babies and toddlers hear out of in-person human faces, the better. Painful emotional memories from early childhood can cause psychological challenges later in life. The human mind tends to create stories from our earliest experiences that can create belief systems that lie buried in the unconscious mind. Invisible negative mindsets can influence behaviour and the development of a healthy sense of self. Statistically, little girls are more robust than little boys. Parental stress is much higher than it was 30 years ago, especially for mothers. Chapter 3, Supporting the Growth of a Fragile Brain. Daniel J. Siegel and Tina Payne Bryson write in The Whole Brain Child, findings from various areas of developmental psychology suggest that everything that happens to us, the music we hear, the people we love, the books we read, the kind of discipline we receive, the emotions we feel, profoundly affects the way the brain develops. The first real-life hint I got that little girls are possibly sharper than little boys happened when my eldest granddaughter, Miss E, was just over 18 months of age. I was watching from the lounge as she stood outside the kitchen in the family's apartment, deep in thought. I don't remember my boys being thoughtful. They were always so impulsive. Then I saw her head towards Daddy, and I'm pretty sure I saw her smile sweetly as she asked, "Can I have a biscuit, please?" Now, her mummy was in the kitchen and would have been much closer to the biscuit jar. What Miss E did was ponder deeply before making her approach to the parent who was most likely to grant her request at 18 months of age. The second experience that astounded me was with another of my granddaughters, Miss M. When she was around 18 months, her parents had left her with us for a weekend to attend a wedding. It was December, so Christmas decorations were up and my endless Christmas music was in full swing. She was sitting on my rocking chair eating some kiwi fruit when she started to sing. In perfect tune, she sang the whole of Jingle Bells without missing a word and in perfect tune. A response in the Parents and Educators survey said, "When my daughter was two, we were out shopping, and she answered the shop phone and said hello and was trying to talk to the customer." Brain architecture. In this chapter, we'll explore a simplified version of this growth and development while introducing you to some really significant, relatively new findings that can explain some of the confusing behaviours and experiences with which our little girls can struggle. Put simply, babies and toddlers' brain development is about the integration of different parts of the brain over time. The Whole Brain Child by Daniel Siegel and Tina Payne Bryson explores how the brain develops from the bottom to the top, meaning that the executive functioning part of our brain in our prefrontal cortex grows very gradually. It is a shame it takes so long to complete its development, as it is not until the mid-20s that it tends to become fully competent. Siegel and Bryson call this vertical brain development. Horizontal brain development, integrating the left and right brain, also takes time. Let's start at the very beginning. Our babies are born with 2 billion brain cells called neurons with very few connectors. This is really good news because it means that the baby's head is smaller than it would be if it had lots of connectors, called synapses. It is definitely something I was grateful for. For a baby to create connectors via axons, the long thread-like nerve fibres, it needs to interpret the stimuli from the environment via the secret ingredient of experience. The Brain That Changes Itself by Norman Doidge explains that this process, happening over and over again when connectors are formed between neurons, creates neural pathways. When a neuron connects to another neuron via a connector called an axon, it becomes a neural pathway. The more times that pathway is used, the stronger it becomes, and this is how our children learn everything from how to walk, how to dress themselves, or how to clean their teeth. Imagine your toddler daughter learning to walk or crawl. The brain gradually builds a strong neural pathway that will help her do it automatically at some point. The thing that improves our ability to.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.